like to visit us in a couple of weeks' time. And unfortunately, the college is fully booked. And they have asked us, the pastoral team, to present the matter to you, our dear members, to see if we, as a community, can accommodate 12 male and 5 female, 2 instructors, 2 teachers, and some secondary school children in our homes for 2 nights.
Concert, that's maybe one of the last events, maybe it's not the last one. The children have still the opportunity to take part by to practice after the children's story this morning in the school hall. And I also have to tell you some membership transfers. We have, it's the first reading, so it will be voted later on.
But after our nice lovely meals, we'll be able to go for this nice walk that we normally go on. This morning, I want to welcome you as you fellowship with us. I would like to begin this service by asking you to sing a song, hymn number 310. That's 310. Thank you.
Because that would bring the thoughts on the things of God. But recently I've come to understand that theologically, God created this earth really beautifully. And then through the fall, the world deteriorated.
Thank you.
And I feel privileged to be with you this morning. I've been blessed by a trio, the music, the sunshine outside, and your smiles, a perfect harmony. It is always a great pleasure for me to be in the early service. And I am blessed, I am always reminded how blessed I am. I came to that point where I know many of you, whereby I share the scripture reading in the title of my sermon, and Sandra is able to find better songs that I would have found myself. And I cherish this moment, and I will hold it in my heart forever. Last Thursday, I accompanied my wife to Windsor for some business I am not particularly fond of, simply because if I need something, I have the Amazon and eBay apps on my phone, and also Wish, which is probably the cheapest online store ever. And as you can see, because the projector at the back was not switched on, I used my phone to sing the two hymns that we sang together. Nevertheless, I went, and I can't tell you how glad I am I went. Those who know me would find it hard to believe I say this, but I'm genuinely happy. I took a couple of hours to go, because I experienced something unique. I'd say I experienced a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity most people don't get. And again, I am reminded how blessed I am. I saw the Queen. Her Majesty, Queen Elizabeth II, passed by less than 4 meters from where I was. And I do have a video clip. If you're friends with me on Facebook, you can go and see it. I'm going to show it to our brothers in the family service. I felt privileged. And I don't get excited easily, but this time I took some moments to reflect on her life and reign. And those of you who probably watched this on the news, you would agree with me that I saw beauty and dignity, generosity, compassion, patience, a deep sense of duty. A true queen was passing by with a genuine fragrance of humility. A royal presence revealed through simplicity and a unique smile. I saw the queen, and I am not even one of her subjects yet. I did not ask for an audience with her. It just happened I was at the right time, at the right place. How often do you cross paths with the Queen? This memorable experience of mine reminded me of an old story of the New Testament. The episode when some Greeks asked for an audience with Jesus. Generally speaking, Greeks were not very interested in Jesus because they had their own philosophers. On Thursday, I felt a bit like those Greeks. My king, King Michael of Romania, who is still alive and lives in Switzerland, still in exile. I have my king. He's a third cousin of the queen and some other monarchs in Europe. Why would I get excited and interested in seeing the Queen of England? By the way, I never got to see my king so close, ever. And I would probably never do it. Not many Greeks expressed their desire to see Jesus. Maybe these were some new converts, or just tourists visiting their religious attractions of their time. However, we have a problem here. We were given absolutely no clue whether the Greeks got to see Jesus or not. I would have loved to witness the conversation. Welcome, gentlemen. How are you? Jesus said. Very well, Jesus. We are excited to meet you. We've never seen you in person. We've heard of you, but now here we are. We've heard a lot about you, about your actions, about your miracles, in particular the resurrection of Lazarus. Unbelievable. You probably know that most of our philosophers do not believe in the resurrection you describe it. To which Jesus would reply, well, gentlemen, the reality is that an even more spectacular resurrection will take place pretty soon. I feel a bit confused. John is not the kind of a writer to leave important details out. Did Jesus meet with the Greeks or not? This silence leads me to speculate. Maybe Jesus changed his attitude from a loving and caring one to indifferent and arrogant. Instead of talking to the visitors, he delivers a sermon. More so, the Greeks do not complain, and we have no evidence of their possible frustration in regards to Jesus' attitude. What is happening here? Let's read the story in John chapter 12, and I'm going to start from verse 20. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. Philip went to Andrew. Andrew and Philip, in turn, told Jesus. Jesus replied, and from here, we almost enter a different story. The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. And the sermon continues. Maybe our understanding of what seeing Jesus means should accommodate also seeing Jesus from a distance as an acceptable way of meeting him. See, many times we want to see Jesus, and we do so for a myriad of reasons. And all we get in return is a sermon. A sermon about some mysterious concepts such as, we read in verse 25, anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. I would like to believe that the Greeks have heard Jesus' words and they got to see him at least in a similar manner as I saw the Queen. There have been situations when some people wanted to see Jesus, but not to see him per se, but just the word. Say the word Jesus and my servant will be healed. Or the woman was terribly ill. She just wanted to touch Jesus. If we really want to see Jesus, we probably don't need a direct audience with him. Oftentimes we long to see him in a certain manner. But Jesus surprises us with his response. And my belief is that even when Jesus' response is not exactly what we expect, it is us who benefit most from his words. The Greeks came to Jesus for their own sake, but end up hearing the revelation of Jesus' mission on earth. Jesus' response has been heard by a wider audience than Philip and Andrew. And the presence of some Greeks to witness is not just an accident. This story, which by the way is not mentioned in any of the three other Gospels, can be better understood if we place it in a certain context. A few verses above, the Greeks visit, John is quoting Zechariah the prophet, who describes the way Jesus would enter Jerusalem. If you have your Bibles or your phones, switch to Zechariah chapter 9. And the same words can be found in John chapter 12, verses 13, 14, and 15. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And in verse 16 of chapter 12 in John, John explains us that his disciples did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him and that they had done these things to him. Going and get a donkey for Jesus to ride entering Jerusalem. John's use of Zechariah, chapter 9, verses 9 and 10, is suggestive in light of this incident which immediately follows, and the way Jesus responds to it. According to Zechariah, chapter 9, verse 10, Messiah would proclaim peace to the Gentiles, or to the nations, in other translations. And here they come, representatively, of course. Some Greeks want to come to see Jesus, to be told that peace will be unto them as well. Jesus has said that he would lay down his life and that he had other sheep not on the fold. Chapter 10, verse 16. The appearance of these Gentiles wishing to see Jesus indicate that it is time for him to lay down his life. The hour of his glory has come. His return to the Father through death, resurrection, and exaltation. This point is so important for the evangelist that we are never actually told if the Greeks get to see Jesus or not. The point was not if they got to see Jesus, but rather the fact that they were included in Jesus' plan. Let's talk for a minute or two about Philip and Andrew. Many people wanted to see Jesus, talk to him, be healed by him, and oftentimes they would approach Jesus through his disciples. They would be the ones facilitating the encounter between these people and Jesus. However, the Greeks' visit is different, at least on one account. Philip has never been addressed before with Sir. They gave him a title of respect as one worthy of honor because he was in a relationship with Christ. And these have never happened before. If we think about Philip's position amongst the 12 disciples, we realize that he is not one of the leaders like John, Peter, James. He was not the quickest one to reply or to respond to Jesus' questions. He was not the first one to offer his life for Jesus. He was just one of the 12. I can imagine that he was a bit shocked when these groups came to him, addressing him with "Sir." He was so shocked that he went to Andrew. Andrew is in a similar position to his, always in the shadow of his brother, Peter. It is indeed a shock to me when strangers I start casual conversations with begin to question my belief. I always feel a bit strange and tempted to apologize almost for being different. But in fact, the reality is the plan of salvation includes all nations. Not too long ago, I had the privilege to have a conversation with a gentleman in London who told me that he was from Iran. And almost immediately he felt compelled to explain me the differences between Persians and Arabs. And I said, "Thank you, I know exactly what the difference is." He said, "How come most people don't have a clue that most citizens of Iran are Persians, so we are not Arabs?" I said, "You may be surprised to find out how do I know. Our church is very fond of prophecy, and I know that you are the sons and nephews, and your ancestors had a great empire, the Persian Empire." And immediately, instead of allowing him to explain me the differences between them and other nations in the Middle East, I started to talk to him about our prophecy. And he was absolutely mesmerized by the story I shared with him. How it started with the Babylon, and the Persian, the Roman Empire, so on and so forth. And we ended up in Europe. We're still friends to this day. And oftentimes, he calls me just to see how am I doing and if I found anything else from the prophecy. I can always speculate, why did Philip go to Andrew instead of someone else? Maybe because they were friends, they were both shy, or simply because Andrew was nearest to Jesus at that time. The fact remains that they both took the matter to Jesus. And if this was a Netflix series, this is the point when the episode ends. The credit starts rolling. In fact, this would be the end of a whole season. The consequent season starts with a powerful sermon by Jesus. And I'm reading to you from verse 27, chapter 12. The Gospel of John, that is. "Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven saying, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." Therefore the people who stood by and heard it said that it had thundered. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered and said, "This voice did not come because of me, but for your sake. I have no reasons to believe that the Greeks were not in the crowd. In fact, I can imagine them close by Jesus when the voice came, because the voice came for their sake. But now it's not about them, or Philip, or Andrew. Now it's all about Jesus." Many of you know that for the last few months, Newbold Church is being involved in a ministry that's happening in another country, in France. We go every Sunday to help other France to feed the refugees in the Dunkirk refugees camp. We not only feed them, distribute fruits, there's a stack in my office, I'm going tomorrow morning. We play with the kids and also make friends. And friends always share a cup of tea together. One Sunday, not too long ago, one of them asked me if he can take a picture with the logo on my high visibility vest. And I said, of course, but why? He said, because as soon as I settle down somewhere, I will definitely go to search for your church. I had one with that at this logo hat with Adam. And I have to admit that we don't go there to preach the gospel or to promote the doctrines or even the prophecy, the understanding of the prophecy we have as a church. We go there just maybe to fulfill what Jesus asked us to do, to feed the hungry and visit those that are not in very fortunate situations. And I never expected that he would say that. There are a few Christians in that camp, but he's not one of them. You see, I was in a conversation where he was sharing tea with me. I wasn't giving him anything. I was there just have a conversation and make him feel that he's not alone. Some Greeks always come to us. And you and I oftentimes find ourselves in the position Philip and Andrew were. And you may be surprised that they would come to you and say, sir or madam, I'd like to see Jesus. And my question to you this morning is, what are we going to do? Because Jesus may happen to give them a sermon. We don't want Jesus to give them a sermon. But that is the most important thing that they may need. To hear Jesus' plan for them, for mankind, that includes ourselves as well. Who are the Greeks in your life that come to you asking, I want to see Jesus? I would like to believe that we are all excited to be near Jesus. I like to believe that we enjoy being with Jesus, even in the most difficult moments of Jesus' life, because this episode precedes the death of Jesus. In fact, some Bibles have this subtitle, Jesus predicts his death. Allow those Greeks to come to you. Take those Greeks to Jesus. And if you are kind of shy or you don't know what to do, go to Andrew, your friend. Present the matter to some of your closest acquaintances or friends and pray for these people and ultimately take them to Jesus. I pray that you will be in that kind of relationship with Jesus that will allow you to take these Greeks to Jesus. Because Jesus himself proclaimed peace to all nations, and his dominion, Zechariah says, will be from sea to sea and from the river to the end of the earth. And I sincerely believe that day is coming soon, and I wish all of us will be there together with our priests. Amen.
This morning I'd like to close the service by singing hymn number 577. In the hand of Jesus. And as we do so, the offering will be taken up. That's 577, in the hand of Jesus. Thank you.
so much that we have this privilege to come here and worship you. We thank you for the Sabbath day. Lord, we thank you that you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to come on this earth. He showed us the example. And he has studied this lesson, and he's going to give us his view of what he's learned from this week's lesson. So we thank you, Dotton, for being here.
Good morning, happy Sabbath, everyone.
Good morning.
I just need to put up some disclaimer before I go into this, because I'm not a theologian, I'm not a student of Newbold or anything. These are just the thoughts of my own head as I go through the lesson. So I'm just giving you a window into my own mind and my heart. Rise up and walk. And faith and healing. And I'm thinking to myself, why can I not do that? Why can I not say that to someone, just get up and walk? Because Jesus did say that, greater works than this you will do. And how come I can't do that, or I don't see anyone do that? I don't know whether you can do that. Do we have anyone in the church who has done that before? Yeah, being born and growing up in the church, I don't see anyone. I haven't seen someone do that. I've heard of someone within the church raise the dead. I have. I haven't seen it, but I have heard of it, and I know the person. So, but why not me? Why can't I do that? And I ask myself, do I trust doctors for a surefire solution than I trust God? When I go to, when I have a headache or something, a flu, what comes to my mind first? Is it to ring for a doctor's appointment or to pray? If I can't just pray if I come on the flu and come on headache and get rid of it, how can I approach someone and say, get up and walk? You know, and I'm thinking about this. If you cast your mind back into the scriptures, when Jesus was coming down from the Mount of Transfiguration, Peter, James, and John with him, the meta situation where disciples were trying to cast out a demon from some young chap. And we're told that Luke was a medical doctor, also one of the apostles. So if he wasn't up on the Mount of Transfiguration, he was probably there with these people trying to cast out the demons. He was a medical doctor. He couldn't do it. Why? Did Jesus ever refer any case to Luke? He said, oh, that's the doctor, go and see him. Rise up and walk. No, why? I mean, are we, you know, there's the knowledge that we have today in medicine, and it's so advanced. The DNA of man, we know it. Some diseases we can even treat. Stem cells, we can graft, stem cells into some other parts and make some diseases go away, we can even grow body parts from stem cells. This is from knowledge. What can we do relying on the name of Jesus? Calling on the name of Jesus to do something. Are we too comfortable these days with our psychiatrists and our cardiologists and our physiotherapists and our, you know, all the ists and G's and whatever, that the name of Jesus has just gone so weak? And this is what's going through my mind. And that's all knowledge. But they say wisdom is applied knowledge. And the Bible says that wisdom comes from knowing God. So how can we not apply the knowledge that we have of God and of Jesus and turn that into wisdom to be able to do things like this? You know, these are the challenges that come through my mind as I study the lesson. And as is usual, you know, I see some examples of Jesus sending out the disciples. You know, and they said, like, demons were bound for us. We healed lots of diseases. We did this and that, and because Jesus blessed them and sent them out. So, okay, if they're able to do those things with Jesus' blessing, what do I not have? What do we not have today that we don't do this? But it says the Spirit will come upon you and you will become my witnesses. So the Spirit in us makes us witnesses. And when the Spirit is in us, it doesn't just be with us, lives in us, and transforms our lives, gives us fruits that people see. We can, you know, we have the gifts that help us do the witnessing work. And one of them is this healing, miracles, and all that stuff. And also the fruits that Vili was talking about this morning, about, you know, being caring, being loving, being patient, everything. The fruits of the Spirit will come along. And this is, you know, where my thoughts led me. That maybe the Holy Spirit needs to take a more powerful hold of my own life and give me those gifts that the Bible has promised. And maybe the fruits will be more pronounced in my life. And maybe that's something we ought to pray about this morning as we go into our classes. And just, why not me? If God says I can do it, I should be able to do it. The fault is not with him, it's somewhere here. Not up there, somewhere around me. That's where the fault is. If I'm doing the diagnosis and analysis of, you know, where's the weak point? It's definitely around me, not with him. You know, and so I have to ask myself, am I too preoccupied with the world to find time for prayer? Or when I find the time, am I just way too lazy in prayer? Or even when I pray, am I just simply too arrogant to submit and to obey? Where is that fault? Because it doesn't go anywhere higher than my heart. It's not anywhere above. is somewhere here below and somewhere with me. So, this morning as we go into our classes, I want us to ask those same questions, or if you have the answer, please just corner me somewhere and just share what I'm missing, because I'd be glad for the feedback. And I want everyone to also ask themselves, where is it? Why can I not this morning say to someone, rise up and walk? And why can I not deal with the demoniac? Why are people flocking to churches because of miracles today, when in my heart of hearts, I know most of those are fake? Where's the original though? I see the fake, but where's the original? I should be able to point to that, isn't it? Let us ask ourselves this morning as the Holy Spirit leads us, so that we can one, in fact, very soon, maybe next week, this week, today, maybe even now, be able to say to somebody, rise up and walk. May God give us that empowerment from the Holy Spirit, so that we can actually go there and be more powerful witnesses for Him. So as we go into our classes, that should be our objective. And we have all sorts of classes around, different languages we have in here. We have English class here, we have another English class there, we have an English class in the children's room there. There's the Bible study, that's the pastor's class in the vestry there. And several other classes around the campus. If you're a visitor, please feel free. Talk to one of the deacons. They'll be able to point you in the right class for you, but you've come to the right place to meet with God, and you will meet God here today. He's here already, waiting for you. Thank you and have a great day. God bless. That we may be saved. So Lord, we, as we gather this morning, we look into your words. We ask that you grant us the understanding of your word, and let it transform our lives, that we'll be.
He cared for this one, Adam and Eve, came to Satan, a mystery. So let us leave mysteries as they are not explained in the Bible, and focus what is open to us and work on that.